28:7, the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I will praise him. Your heart trusts in the Lord, and you are helped. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Praise you, Jesus. God is good. Darkest can clearly see that God is good. Say this with me, an expected end. Say that. An expected end. The scripture says that God's plans for us are for good and not for evil, to give us a future and a hope, not to harm us. Even when it looks like it's doing that, it's not, because God's a good father. And he doesn't plan on the spur. He has a plan that he's planned before time began. He knows all the details. What he allows is because he knows it's okay, it's good for us. And he will bring us through with an expected end. That means there's a plan. It's not a whoops. There's no whoops with the Lord. An expected end. Praise your name. Standing on the promises of Christ, my King. Thank you. We trust you, O God. You're faithful. We put all of our trust in you today, and we thank you for being faithful.
Yes, Lord.
For being a good father, yes, and a good God.
Thank you.
For being enough.
Thank you.
You're more than enough, Lord.
Thank you.
His strength is perfect when our strength is gone. He'll carry us when we can't carry.
when God decides. How many can remember a time that God had made a decision for you, and maybe for your family, that would have not been your choice? But because you knew it was God choosing, you followed what He had decided. When God decides, how many perceive that to be the final decision? No arguing, no debating, no discussing, no counseling, no advising, just understanding that when God decides, we accept that as the final decision. When you and I were young, take a moment to remember that. It may take a little bit. We probably had parents, grandparents, guardians, etc., that made decisions for us. How many can remember those days? Let me ask you, who makes the decisions in your life today? Now that you're older, much wiser, and legally responsible, who makes the decisions for you today? Come on now, who really makes the decisions? Think about it. We're not going to get into that. We're just thinking about it. Teachers, law enforcement, government officials are making a lot of decisions for us today. Decisions that I would not make. And it's not because I'm stubborn or just want to be different. I just have a different perspective. I think my perspective has been greatly affected by faith in God. And if I did not have that faith and the knowledge that God is who He says He is and can do what He says He can do, I probably wouldn't have the confidence I have. But I'm confident in the Lord. How many can say that today, that you have confidence in God and what He would have you to do? Growing up, I had an older brother that was the oldest in our family, and he thought he knew far more than I did, only being 17 months older than me. And he tried to boss me around. As we age and begin to make some of our own decisions, most often you end up choosing others to help guide you. How many have noticed that? That we are so hesitant to make independent, personal, private decisions without guidance or counsel or input. And sometimes when we invite others to help us make a decision, we are affected by their perceptions and by what's happening in their life without them really understanding what's best for us. They're helping us and giving us input based upon what they see, what they feel, what they know, what they've experienced. But not always is that the best. God does teach us to seek godly counsel that have a proven track record in their life of God's favor and blessing. The Bible says signs will follow them that believe and trust in God. When I got my driver's license, I did not have the benefits that so many in our world have today of someone in my family buying a vehicle for me or giving me the money to buy it. I had to work and come up with whatever I could, and I started out with a bicycle, progressed to a motorcycle, and then I bought a 1955 Buick Special. I called it the Tank. I don't know if you remember the Buick Special. It was huge. And I don't know how many tons it weighed, but oh my goodness. You could not push it unless you had three or four people. It was a beast. So I would make some decisions with my friends before I got my own transportation. And we would decide what we were going to do. And they would say, ask your dad if he will loan you the car. And how many know that it really didn't matter how many plans you made, if it wasn't in his favor, it wasn't going to happen. Dad's decision was pretty final. And the way I was raised, you did not ask a second time. There was a consequence. When Don and I picked out the first home that we purchased in Phoenix when we were pastoring there, we knew that it was the house we wanted. As soon as we walked in, we felt a peace and felt it was the right one. But ultimately, the decision was not made by us. It was made by the lender of the finances to buy the house. Same thing in business. When you are involved in business, if you're working for someone, or even if you are the owner of the company, the decisions of what you can and cannot do is often made not by you, but by people who control the permits and the laws and the county, the city, the federal government. I mean, oh my goodness, and it's getting worse. I'm amazed at the nonsensical decisions that people are making. Not wise always. I learned it's not much different even in the church. Being a pastor, I've learned that I am accountable to a church membership. I'm accountable to a church board. I'm accountable to the state government and the federal government and the religious government of the Assemblies of God. They ask me every year if I'm still doing what I agreed that I would do, still preaching what I agreed to preach. And they want me to back it up sometimes. So I've learned through these experiences of life, I'm sure as you have, that it's good to have the option of making a decision. But oh my goodness, the process and the consequences of our decisions are grave, aren't they? How many can look back? I can look back that I've made more decisions that I wished I hadn't made than I have that I am glad I made. We go through life learning through experience and say, boy, I don't want to do that again. I wouldn't make that decision again. But I don't want to be one of those people, and I don't think you do, that are unable to decide. How many of you decide without any input where you're going to lunch when you go somewhere? Oh my, it's been a lifelong experience. When I was at home, I had never eaten out. When I lived at home with my parents before I left home, we never ate out. But as time has passed, we eat out, and it is always, where do you want to eat? And I will answer, I don't want to go there. Well, where do you want to go? I don't know, just make a decision. Well, I'd already made one, and it was wrong. I don't want to be a person that is unable to decide, especially in the hour that we're living in. We need to determine to be very decisive and be ready to make decisions based upon not only our trust in God and what His Word teaches, But based upon what is right in the moment, we need to walk in the Spirit of God, the Spirit of God's Word, the Spirit of our Father, and in His Holy Spirit, so that we can make quick decisions. We cannot afford to waver or to be driven by the winds of that are blowing politically or medically. We can't live that way, church. We will die. I remember in October of 1961 when I accepted Jesus as my personal Savior. For the first time as a child, my spiritual eyes were open. I did not see fully clear, but I saw things I had never seen before, being raised in a pastor's home. When I found Jesus, for the first time, my spiritual eyes were opening. How many can remember when you got saved? The world looked totally different than it did before that day. And going to church felt totally different and looked different than it did before that day. One of the things that I discovered as I began to read the Bible and begin to understand that I was walking in a personal relationship with the Son of God. And He was helping me to understand God and God's plan. There are multiple layers of decisions. In the wintertime, how many have more than a sheet on your bed? Maybe a blanket and a comforter, maybe a heating blanket as you get older. But we add layers. As you grow older, there are layers to decisions. Those layers have to do with not only what God would have us to do, but what is this going to do to me? What is it going to do to my wife? What is it going to do to my children? What is it going to do to the people who know me? Layers. It's not just, I'm going to make a decision and that's it. How many know what I'm talking about? If you get ready to move, it may be something that you want to do and you feel good about it, but when you begin to talk to the family and they begin to show you, here's another layer, Dad. Here's another perspective. It's my perspective. And I'm not in favor of this. I can make a decision. Someone is going to make the final decision. I have found that my grandkids have a greater impact on my decisions than anyone else. I don't know what it is, but a grandchild holds more authority and power and influence than a child. Anybody know what I'm talking about? They can look at me. Or Elliot called me here a while back and I hadn't talked to him, I don't know, probably in a year or two personally, but he called me. Pappy, can I talk to you? And I was busy. I said, absolutely, I'll stop what I'm doing right now. What's going on? And he kind of went around the barn half a dozen times and finally stopped. Said, well, here's what I'm calling you about. And it shocked me. He wanted to know about the Holy Spirit. He was nervous. Well, it was pretty easy for me to say there's nothing more valuable or more important in your life than receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You will never have full ability to understand without the help of the Holy Spirit. You'll never have strength to do what needs to be done to the capacity that if you have the Holy Spirit. Now, Scripture teaches that, church. It's not pastor's opinion. That's what Scripture says. Let's look at Scripture, Joel chapter 3, reading the first two verses, Old Testament, book of Joel, J-O-E-L, chapter 3, verse 1 and 2. For behold, in those days, and at that time, when I bring back the captives of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat means God has judged. For the sake of our message thought, God has decided. Now look at it again. In those days and at that time when I bring back the captives of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, which means God has decided. God has made the final decision. God is not a God who needs backup or support or someone to agree with him to validate what he's decided. He has the ability, and he is the only one in the universe that has the ability to make a decision, and it's always right. That'd be a good place to say amen. And it's always the best. And so in our passage of Scripture, Joel is telling the people of Israel, wake up, God has made a decision and he's going to inform you of what he's decided. And everyone in the whole world, it says all the nations brought down because God's made a decision, and all the world will stand before him as he gives that final decision about your life. Now this is both literal in the Old Testament, it happened, but it is a prophetic passage about what's about to happen. Our world is facing judgment. And it's not just you and I. It's not just America. Again, as it says in Joel chapter 3, we as a world, all the nations and peoples of the earth will stand before God, and God will have at that moment made the final decision about what's going to happen with your life, where you will spend eternity. I want you to think about that a moment, because it's out of our hands. At that moment, it is out of our hands. There are some things that you and I can do to help God make his final decision. But ultimately, when the time comes and we stand before him, the decision will be made, and there's nothing that we can say or do that will change it. Now, with that in mind, how many would say it's very important that we are conscious of what we need to be doing before we stand before him? If he's going to make a decision about where we spend eternity and what's going to happen forever, we need to be very concerned and conscious about what we can do today to help him make the decision that we will spend eternity with him. How many would say yes? You have a free will to make decisions about how you choose to live your life. Totally up to you. God gave you that, and no matter how many parents you have or how many friends you have or how many grandparents or how many laws and governments and people and rulership and political parties, and no matter what laws they pass, ultimately it's going to be you deciding of what you will do and how you will respond to everything that everybody says to you. That's your responsibility, and it is your right. So let's look at verse 14 of Joel chapter 3. Let's read this next verse. How to align our lives so that we agree with the one who's going to make the final decisions. Verse 14, Joel chapter 3. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. It's another way of saying that no one has missed the final. Everyone is going to be there on that day, and God will be passing out the final decisions for every life. Make no mistake about this. Jesus, his Father, are going to make the final decision. So how do we line up our choices, what we choose to do to get ready for that and stand before God, so that we're in sync with what God would want us to do, would want us to be when we stand before Him? Number one, God tells me that I know enough in order to align my decision about the way I live my life, understanding that He is going to ultimately decide for me what's going to be. He's given us the free will. He tells me, I've given you my word, and it is sufficient for life and death. Scripture says that. So it's kind of like, how many have ever gotten information that we're going to have a final exam, and here is the material. If you can comprehend this material, you'll pass it with flying colors. That is almost never true. Because there are some things that most teachers and most people who establish the tests want to find out if you have the ability to read between the lines. So it's not a matter of just being able to read a book and know what that book says, but do you understand what it means? I'm convinced that most people in Christianity do not understand what it means that they are going to stand before God and God is going to give them the final decision about their life, and it is going to be based upon what they have chosen, not what a priest or a pastor or a parent or a government official or a teacher or a friend, no matter how many there were that were supporting what they thought. God's not going to make His final decision on what they told you. He's going to make the final decision on what you decided in your heart and why you made that decision. Romans chapter 1, verse 20, for since the creation of the world, His invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without any excuse. That's pretty important. God says, you want to know who I am and what I can do and what power I have and how I look at things and what I think is important? Look at the universe. Look at the earth. Look at the flowers, the trees, the animal life, all of creation, because they are a reflection of me, how I feel, what I love, what I think is important, what my power is. That's what He's saying. And I don't need to make any excuses. That's Romans chapter 1, verse 20. With the scripture right here, God takes away one of the greatest excuses that mankind has ever had. How many of you as teenagers said to your parents or your dad, person in authority, I didn't know? I didn't know that was bad. I didn't know that I shouldn't have driven 100 miles an hour. I'd never driven 100 miles an hour before. A good example would be what happened this last week to Tiger Woods. He was in an area that he was not real familiar with, driving early in the morning. He was in a hurry to a meeting, and he came upon a road, passage of road that I have traveled on that is very dangerous. And even though there's speed markings and there are curb markings, how many drive and you try to do more than what the signs say because you know that there's potential of having an accident in an area you're not familiar with? Most people take this mindset. I can handle it. I'm a good driver. Vroom. We're on our way. But God says, Romans 1:20, I'm going to take away all your excuses because I'm going to literally paint you a picture of who I am, what I love, what I can do, what I'm willing to do, the fact that I can perpetuate things over generations of time, and it summer, spring, winter, fall, birds, just everything that God does that keeps going whether there's a COVID or not. I made plans, and my dad constantly changed my plans. I don't ever remember, ever, my dad saying, that's a good idea, go for it. There was always, well, maybe, but. And sometimes there was another but, and another but, and if you do this, I want you to know this is going to happen. If you do that, I'm thinking, all I wanted to do was just go to the store. And I'm getting the Ten Commandments rewritten. You might tell my boss that I did not get done what he wanted me to do. How many have ever told a boss that? Well, I didn't get it done. But according to how important it was to my boss, it may not have been that important to me because I didn't get it done. But how important it was to my boss, I may have or may not have a job. According to how we respond to what God's word has said, we may or may not make heaven. It won't be our decision. It will be His based upon our thoughts, our emotions, and our choices. You might tell the bank approving your loan that I did not know that buying that new car months before I decided to buy the house would throw lending ratios out of whack and keep me from getting the house loan because I felt I needed the car before I needed the house. Neither can I stand nor you before Christ at the time of judgment and tell Him that I did not know my decisions about how I was living my life was going to affect your decision. But it will. When we talk to our loved ones, we need to talk to from not the basis of just what's happened to us and the fears of them repeating what we've done, but talk to them based upon what God says so that they have the person who's going to make the final decision about eternity for them. Come on now, are you listening? You see, when we make a decision, we can't do it because everyone else agrees with us. Because if they're not in agreement with God, we're going to miss heaven. Everybody in the world may think it's all right to change your sex. They're teaching our children before they get into school that it's all right to decide what you want to be. Forget the fact that you were born a certain way. I believe that God made us in the way, in the image He wanted us to be. And there's no big biblical shims. Have she, have him. And there's no reversing creation. That's not pastors mean-heartedness. It's just based upon truth. God's going to make the final decision, and we need to know what God thinks and why He made us the way He made us. God's response is going to be to everyone who tries to use that excuse that you didn't know is, but I told you in multiple ways. I showed you what was right. God tells us that we have the power to make the choice to align our decisions about life and the way we're going to live and respond to life so that we will have God's decision be the right one for our future. And it will be the best one. Joshua 24:15, if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, and many people in the world think it's evil, choose for yourselves this day who you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we are going to serve the Lord. Hopefully you've made that decision. And it's not based upon what a pastor has said or an evangelist or your favorite speaker or your most influential religious friend, but it's based upon what thus saith the Lord. Please don't make your decisions on how you're going to serve God based on how you feel and what you think. Know what God says. Because when the final decision about eternity is made, you want to have been basing your decisions upon what God has said. 1 Kings 18:20-21, so Ahab sent for all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets to Mount Carmel. And Elijah came to all the people and said, how long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him. But the people answered him not a word. You know, the Lord says this in Scripture. If you're not going to do what he's teaching you to do in Scripture, then go on out into the world, eat, drink, and live it up, because tomorrow you are going to die. And that will be the only joy you'll ever have. You will have no joy and peace halting between serving God and serving the world. You're going to be miserable. So go on and live life to the fullest. Do whatever you want to do and be happy about it, because the final decision is coming. And there will be no change in it. And if you don't decide before that decision, God will decide for you. And if you haven't decided for Jesus, you will miss heaven. Think about that a moment. With those two scriptures that we've just read, I'm told it's in my hands to decide. It's in your hands for you. How to align my life so that when I stand before God, I will enter into the joy of the Lord for eternity. When Jesus arose from the grave, which we are hastening toward, can you believe we're starting March tomorrow? Surprise! Wow! How time is marching on. 1st of March tomorrow. Easter's coming fast. When Jesus arose from the grave on Resurrection Sunday, He gave every human being a gift of power that no matter who they were, what they were, where they were, who was around him, who was making decisions for them, he gave every human being the power on earth to live a resurrected life, to become a believer and follower of him, and no one could stop. He hopes that we make the choice to follow him. but he urges us to make a decision. Yes or no? Let me make sure you understand what that means. Your mom and dad might be good Christian people, but they cannot make the choice for you. Joshua was pretty specific. Choose for yourself this day. Choose for yourself. Elijah was pretty specific. If God is God, then follow him. If you believe Baal is God, then follow him. Make a decision. Your praying grandma cannot pray you into heaven. Her prayers may move God to you in situations where you might be given the opportunity to choose to follow him. But you alone are the only person that holds the power to make the decision of how you're going to stand before God in eternity. No one else does that. No one else has that power but you. As badly as I wish I could just give the gift of salvation to every human being and it would work, I can't. I wish I could just give salvation to my children and my grandchildren, but I can't. But I must give them the picture. I must give them the knowledge. I must live before them the testimony that I can hopefully impact for them to make their own decision to believe in Jesus, to receive Jesus, and to follow Jesus, because when we stand before God, they will stand alone. And no matter what I say or how many tears I cry, I cannot impact the final decision. It's God's. The Bible says literally, to know him whom to know means life eternal. It doesn't say to know about him. It doesn't say to have a perspective of him. It doesn't say to believe that he is God. But it says to know him. To know him, have a personal relationship with him. Whom to know means life eternal. Acts 26, verse 28, then Agrippa said to Paul, you almost persuade me to become a believer. This is the king. Paul's been arrested for preaching the gospel, doing the things that he was doing, trying to serve the Lord. He made a decision on the road to Damascus to change following the religious teachings of Gamaliel and the church and follow Jesus. The Lord changed his name from Saul to Paul, changed his outlook, his perspective, changed his soul and his heart and his mind, and he became a follower of Jesus. And Paul shared that testimony of what had happened to him, and the king said, you almost persuade me to become a follower as you have. Agrippa says, almost convinced me to be a Christian, but I'm not going to make that decision. God says, we have a lot of decisions to make. We're living in a valley full of decisions. The most important one is decide to follow and to know the Lord. What Agrippa didn't say is just as important. Agrippa didn't say that I am more convinced now having listened to you that following the Roman God is not the way to go. He didn't say that. He said, I'm almost persuaded to follow and become a believer. What he just said is I'm not going to decide. I'm just going to go on like I'm going. Now, church, and you're here today and other people aren't, and there may be some that are listening to the message online, but if you hear this message, This is not a message that I'm preaching because I decided to. God decided for me as I prayed. And he impressed upon me the importance of understanding the hour is drawing close for all of us, that God's going to make our decision. And we need to be sure that we're ready. Be very sure, the old song says, your anchor holds and grips the solid rock of Christ. God tells us that since I knew enough to make the right decision, and because I had the power that he gave me to make the right decision, that when the final decision is made by Christ, it's all on me. Because he gave us the knowledge to know him, the opportunity to know him. He showed himself in multiple ways to us. Come on now. He gave us the power, the free will to make that decision. No one, no amount of people could keep us from making that personal decision to believe and to receive Christ and to follow him. So his decision is based upon ours, or the fact that we didn't make one. Not making one is just as tragic as making the wrong one. Galatians 6, verse 7 and 8, do not be deceived. God will not be mocked. For whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. For he who sows to the flesh will reap of the flesh corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. That's what it comes down to. What you're living, what you're thinking, what you're feeling, what you're doing, how you're responding to life and to people, to circumstances. It's telling you whether you're ready or not. It's telling you already, what's God going to decide? You're making the decision. He's just going to inform you of what you've already decided. He's going to clarify it. So what this tells me is that when you make your choice, the final decision that God's going to make will be to make sure that the consequences go along with the choice that you made. What do you want eternity to be? Because the way you're living, thinking, feeling, and doing is going to decide what eternity is going to be. So no one can say if they are sent to eternal hell that Christ did this to me. Unbelievers are constantly saying, how could a God of love send people to an eternal fire and damnation? God doesn't. He just informs us of the decision that we've already made. What's going to be so terrible, the Bible says that there will be multitudes of people that have been deceived into thinking that what they thought, felt, and decided was good enough because some pastor told them it was, or some family member said, oh, you're the best person I know. You don't need to do all that stuff in the Bible or in Scripture. You're just a good person. Folks, we need to know him. God does not demand perfection. He knows that we can't do it. But he does require faith, that we make the decision to believe who he is, what his word says, who he is, and that we will stand before him and that he is going to inform us, because based upon what you thought, felt, think, and did, here's where you spend eternity. Someone said to me on the phone a few days ago, I guess it's been two or three weeks now, Pastor, I am making the decision because I really have no other choice. I can't live in this environment anymore. I'm dying and I have just a few weeks left, maybe days, and I can't live in this environment anymore. And I'm asking for your approval to make this decision. And I was very honest. I mean, he had me crying. He was weeping. I was crying because I related to some of the things that he's going through. I said, I can't make that decision for you. That's something that you need to spend some time fasting and praying. Because you need to, number one, know that you are in guidelines of Scripture and that what you're doing is not going to cross a boundary with God. You may feel like you can't stand what's happening, and I went back to what Jesus said. Father, is there any way you could change my circumstance? Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And he endured the death of the cross, bearing our sorrow, sin, and shame, and iniquities, and died. But in the process, he was looking for a way out. But when he came back to knowing the will of the Father, he said, never mind, not what I'm wanting, but what you have said needs to happen. Thy will be done. If you don't remember anything else from this message this morning, remember this, there is one and only one. His name is Jesus, who can help you make the right final decision. And I have been reflective over the last few weeks especially, asking God to show me, please open the eyes of my heart that I can see clearly, because with all that's happening and all that I'm going through and feeling, not just as a person, but as a husband, a father, a grandfather, a pastor, all that is happening, God, I don't want to misstep here. I'm just about there. What a tragedy if I would deceive myself into believing that I'm okay when I'm not. Be sure. As we close today, we're going to take some moments to pray. Be sure. Based upon who God is and what God has said, the letters that he has given us, be sure that you know him. Because if you don't, his decision is already made and he can't change it. Let me give you this before we close. God says, I am not willing that any one of you should perish. John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He's not willing. He does not want you to miss heaven. But be very clear about this. The way you're living, thinking, and feeling is already making his decision. Be sure that what he says to you in judgment will be what you want to hear. Can we pray? The Bible says, unless the righteousness of the New Testament believer exceed the righteousness of the Pharisees, we will never see God. So it's not the obedience, it's not the legalism, it's not knowing the letter and doing it because we're told to. It's having the heart. Having come to know God and loving Him because He loves you and wanting more than anything else in your life to spend eternity with Him. God will take care of the rest. He'll talk to you. He'll walk with you. He'll give you strength. He'll give you power. He'll give you peace. Whatever you need, God will give it to you. But you've got to make a decision today. Who are you going to serve? Where do you want to spend eternity? And then protect that. Every breath and every day. Because judgment is coming. The valley of Jehoshaphat. God's final decisions are going to be passed out. Father, as we bow our hearts before your throne today, would you speak to us? Some of us, Lord, have pursued you through our life. Many, Lord, have known you for a good percentage or majority of their lives. Some may have come here today not fully knowing you, not fully believing in you. But Lord, would you help us this Sunday, help us to make a decision. No longer torn between whether we're going to believe or whether we believe that you are God or Jesus is your son and died for us. We're going to make the decision today. Yes, I'm going to invite Jesus into my heart, ask him to forgive me, ask him to walk with me and teach me and guide me and direct me. And Lord, those of us who have served you and been influenced by religion and been affected and influenced by so many people who followed you and represented you. Oh Lord, let us not be confused and deceived by anything that has happened to us or around us, but help us to know you personally more than ever before, to be willing to allow you to sit upon the throne of our heart and your word and your spirit to speak to us and to give us a heart, Lord, that is tender and willing and yielded and sensitive, so that we're ready to stand before you on the final day of decision. In Jesus' name. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst bids me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. I come just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come. I come just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come. I come. If you're here this morning and you've ever remembered inviting Jesus into your heart, I would be honored to pray with you to receive him today. You can either raise your hand and I'll make it to where you are, or you can come forward and I'll pray with you here. Make a decision today. If you're one who served the Lord at a different time, but because of things in life you've drifted away and you can't say that you're sure, but you want to be, come let me pray with you. Let's make a decision before anything else happens. Would you do that? Just as I am, poor, wretched, blind, sight rich is healing of the mind. Yea, all I need in thee to find, O Lamb of God, I come. I come just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. I come. Thank you, Lord of heaven. Thank you, Lord Jesus of my heart. Thank you, Father, for your word and your spirit. Oh, Lord, would you walk with us, teach us, guide us, direct us into complete and full surrender, that we have no anxious heart about the day of decision. We, Lord, with faith and expectancy, look to hear, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord forevermore." Help us to be ready. Help us, our heart, our mind, our thoughts, our motives, Lord, to be surrendered and yielded, that we will receive that final decision when we stand before you. We pray these things in the wonderful name of your Son, Jesus. Hallelujah. God bless you, church. Don't wait, don't linger, don't live in the valley of indecisiveness. Make sure every day that you know the Lord. We don't know the hour nor the day that He's coming, but I believe and I'm praying it will be soon. God richly bless you. Have a wonderful rest of your week. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you for the faithfulness of your Spirit. Thank you.